Welcome to Questions for Christians. My name is Bernie Dehler. I'm a former evangelical, born-again Christian. I'm now an atheist. And I do this show to talk to other Christians who are both promoters of the faith and defenders of the faith. Those are called evangelists and apologists. And today I have with me Fazale Rana. He goes by the nickname of Fuzz. Hi, Fuzz.
Hi, Bernie. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for coming on the show. I've really been looking forward to this show a lot. I have so much I'd like to talk to you about. Just to give an overview of what we're going to do, we're going to have 5 10-minute sections and then a wrap-up section. The first section is going to be, how should we interpret the Adam and Eve story in light of modern science? The second one is, how should we interpret the Noah's Ark story in light of modern science? The third one is morality grounded in God? The fourth one is, can you feel the presence of God? And the fifth one is addressing this question, why is there something rather than nothing? And some people say, with multiverse theory in mind, why is there something instead of everything? Just to make a funny spin on that. So I guess we'll start the show now. And Fuzz, I would like you to take about 60 seconds and just explain who you are to somebody who's never heard your name before.
Sure thing. Well, I work for an organization called Reasons to Believe. And the focus of our organization is to show people that there is scientific evidence for God's existence and the reliability of Scripture. And I'm a biochemist by training and have been with the organization for 16 years. And I write and I speak in different venues about science faith issues.
And you've published a number of books and you've been involved in a number of debates, right?
Yes, I've written several books, Origins of Life, The Cell's Design, Creating Life in the Lab. All three deal with the origin of life question proper. Mm. And then I've also written a book called Who Was Adam? And then have debated a number of notable atheists and skeptics, Michael Ruse, for example, and P.Z. Myers.
Okay, by the way, I'll tell you, I'm wearing a shirt. It says, things just got weird. Just to make it kind of funny here. Hopefully we're going to get into some weird things people don't normally talk about. Okay, so first, our first segment here is on Adam and Eve. And so basically this is just meant to be a dialogue. We can talk back and forth. Now, as I understand it, you believe that... why don't you give me a quick overview of how you believe that Adam and Eve were created?
Yes, well... you know, when it comes to the creation account regarding human origins, there's two prominent views among evangelicals. One would say that the account of human origins is theologically true, but it's not historically and scientifically true necessarily. And then another group of evangelicals, which I would be part of, would argue that it is actually a historical account. And if that's the case, then we would expect that there should be scientific evidence that lines up with the biblical account of human origins. And so I would look at the biblical account at face value, that there was literally an Adam and an Eve that were created through God's direct intervention, made in his image.
Okay, so to summarize, tell me if you think this is fair or not. I think you might be what they call a progressive creationist, where God, through the eons, you know, like maybe at 1 million years, he created these creatures. Another 1 million years later, he created another set of creatures. So at some point in time, he created humans where there was no humans at all. And then boom, the next day, there's Adam and Eve. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, I would be called a progressive creationist. And you did, I think, a really good job of describing that position.
Okay, so in your worldview, in your theology, in your scientific understanding, there was a point in history where one day there was no humans at all, and the next day, what, there's two humans, just Adam and Eve, and then all humans descended from those two?
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah, I would take the view that they were the first human beings, again, created, as you mentioned, through God's direct and personal intervention, mm-hmm. that they have no connection historically to creatures like Neanderthals or Homo erectus that preceded modern humans in the fossil record, and that all humanity ultimately descends from a, an Adam and an Eve.
So like a Neanderthal then is also a separate creature, a separate creation, just kind of boom, there's a Neanderthal where there was nothing before that.
Yes, exactly. That's right.
Okay, now would you, and you would also say that for all the other major animals, like for example, hippos, elephants, lions, and tigers, there's a point in time where there is none, and then there's a certain point where boom, all of a sudden there's a bunch of tigers?
Yeah, that's in a sense that would be the position. Although from my perspective, while I'm a skeptic of aspects of the evolutionary paradigm, I would allow for some evolution happening in a limited extent. So I have no problem with the idea of microevolution or speciation, where you would have God creating a design, and then that design is capable of varying, again, through natural process mechanisms. So, you know, but yes, in a sense, we would argue that with each of the creatures that we see, the basic design that is represented by that creature, the archetype, is essentially the product of a creator's activity.
Mm-hmm. And like evolutionists, for example, will say that there were mammals on land and they went back in the sea, and that's how we have whales, for example. So you would say, no, that never happened, that there was just a point in time when, boom, there were some kind of whale creature.
Yeah, that there was a creation event, exactly.
Okay. Let me throw this out there and see what you think about this. I believe that, you know, sometimes people say there's science versus religion, and I would argue that, and I know you would argue against that. And I'd like to say that basically the argument really is magical thinking versus scientific thinking. And the scientific thinking would be, for example, evolution, which explains how things emerge, whereas magical thinking is, you know, like boom, things pop into existence. You know, you could say creation by poof, you know, there it is, poof. And that's it. What would you have to say about that?
Well, you know, let's put it this way. I wouldn't frame it as, again, magical thinking versus scientific thinking, because, for example, I think science has the capacity to detect whether or not intelligent agency is involved in a causative event. So, for example, if you look at the archaeological record, we have stone tools that creatures like, let's say, Homo habilis produced. Anthropologists and archaeologists are capable of examining a rock and determining that that rock was the product of intelligent agency versus that the rock was shaped through natural processes. And so my view would be not, again, magical thinking versus scientific thinking, but rather that science has the capacity to detect the work of an intelligent agent. And so we would argue that when we look at the history of life on Earth, we see places where it does look like intelligent agency was involved in bringing about, again, the origin or the existence of particular life forms.
So you brought up Homo habilis. So you're saying that's not a human, though, right?
No, well, I mean, I would argue it's not a modern human or Homo sapiens sapiens, and that that creature would have lacked what I would understand to be the image of God.
Okay.
But it would be a human in the sense that it belongs to the genus Homo.
So that's a different species than like Adam and Eve, for example. I mean, Adam and Eve are one kind of species, and that's a different species. They shouldn't be. They wouldn't mate, or maybe they did because of sin, or what?
Oh no, I mean, Homo habilis was cognitively different than modern humans. It was the creature was clearly biologically distinct from modern humans.
Okay.
And so, the way I would think of that creature would be in the same vein that I would think of chimpanzees, orangutans, and gorillas. Creatures that had intelligence, had emotional capability, creatures that were, you know, fascinating creatures in their own right, but yet distinct species from modern humans.
Would you say they had a soul? Because some people say only humans have souls, and some people say all the animals have souls.
I would say that they had, again, an intelligence and emotional capability, but I would not say that they bore the image of God. That would be the terminology that I would use.
And what is the image of God exactly? Because as far as I can tell, it's never defined. So what would you say is the image of God?
Yeah, well, that's a fair question or a fair point, because Scripture makes the assertion that human beings are made in God's image, but it doesn't define what that means precisely. And so, you know, theologians have debated that over the centuries. And the particular view that I embrace would be something called a resemblance view, where human beings have certain capabilities, advanced cognitive capabilities that would resemble, though imperfectly, but resemble that of the Creator. So we would have the capacity for abstract thought, for language and artistic and musical expression, and things like that. And so that capability would be something that an anthropologist would label as symbolism. So the closest scientific analog to the image of God, I would argue, is symbolism.
But it seems like we see that in the lower life forms, too. I mean, there's a lot of, they display some communication abilities. Even, you know, Franz De Waal wrote that book of Primates and Philosophers, and he talked about emergent signs of morality with chimps and... okay, well, we're almost out of time on this topic. One thing I really wanted to bring up, is there anything you wanted to say? I mean, I want to cut you off. Is there anything you want to say before I ask another subtopic here?
No, that's fine. We can move on.
Okay, one thing I'm really chomping at the bit to know about is, I know you talked to Dennis Vinema before. You've had debates with him. He's a Christian practicing scientist who fully accepts evolution. And in his video, he talks about how pseudogenes are, you know, evidence of evolution. Just the fact that, you know, and he cites this paper about the olfactory sense alone, where there is a study of like 50 of these pseudogenes for the olfactory sense. This is our sense of smelling. And for example, there's one gene that everything in the line of descent inherits. And then if you look at where the orangutans branch off, there's three more pseudogenes that the gorillas and the chimps and the humans inherit or seem to have. Then if you break off the gorilla branch, there's three that the chimp and the human share. And then when you go off that branch, the chimps have 4 and the humans have 15. So it seems like there's an obvious descent here. So why, I don't understand, why is this not obvious slam dunk evidence that humans evolved from other animals?
Well, we actually addressed that question pretty significantly in the update to Who Was Adam that we just published. And basically what we point out is that this idea that pseudogenes are non-functional doesn't have, I think, any kind of genuine scientific support.
Let me interrupt. It's the argument is not that they're non-functional. It's just that, I mean, you can actually see the gene, how it's expressed and everything. I mean, this is the olfactory sense. They have the ability to sense smells, and we don't, because we have genes that are hacked up, and so we no longer have that sense, but we have the gene. So it's not a matter of non-functional genes. It's a matter of seeing how these genes are chopped up through descent according to evolutionary trees.
Yeah, well, and I talk about this also in the update to Who Was Adam, is that when you actually are building evolutionary trees with humans, chimps, bonobos, and gorillas, and orangutans, is that depending on the particular section of the genome that you look at, you actually get different trees. So, for example, certain regions of the human genome are much more closely aligned with the gorilla genome than with the chimpanzee genome. And that's about 30%, if I'm not mistaken, I'm going off the top of my head at the moment, I think it's about 30% of the gorilla genome more closely aligns with the human genome than the chimp genome. So the idea that you see that particular relationship with those sets of genes is actually, again, looking at a particular set of genes in particular regions of the genome. If you went to other regions, you get a very different story. And so to me, that incoherence is raising certain questions, and I think, again, I think you can't explain those patterns that you see in the context that there is a functional reason why those patterns exist. And by the way, when you actually examine some of the pseudogenes, you don't get that relationship. Some of the olfactory pseudogenes, you actually get a different relationship.
Okay, so what I hear you saying is, okay, so are you denying then, you know the paper he's referring to, right? That it was
Yes.
It's called Human-Specific Loss of Olfactory Receptor Genes. Are you saying that this paper is flawed?
No, I wouldn't say that. What I would say is that the way in which the data is interpreted is from within the context of an evolutionary framework.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is they're cherry picking that there is, it looks like there is a sequence that shows evolution, but there's other sequences that do not line up this way, and they are not mentioning that. So are you basically saying they're cherry picking here?
No, I wouldn't use that term at all. I think they're interpreting the data within a particular context, within a particular framework, that you could actually adopt an alternate framework, one that would employ design as an organizing principle, and equally interpret the data in a design context where you're seeing functionality.
Well, so here's a specific question. So it says, there's this mammalian gene sequence, they're saying, and then they're saying that the humans have 15 corrupted versions, so no longer have those sense of smells for those certain things. And then if you go up a level between the human and chimp, there's three more. And if you go up a level between the gorilla one, a branch, there's three more. And if you go up before the orangutan branch, there's one more. So we have these genes that no longer sense these smells, but as you go, I'm trying to understand, if God made humans uniquely from scratch, why would we have these genes that, you know, you could say maybe they found a function for it, the body uses a function for some of these, but it's obviously these are made for the olfactory sense, because that's how they actually work in other ancestral streams.
Well, but a couple of things that are in play here. Is number one, there's been some recent work, again, in understanding pseudogene function, and there's an idea emerging called the competitive endogenous RNA hypothesis, where the argument is that messenger RNA molecules are not only harboring information that would be used to translate proteins during the process of gene expression, but that the information in messenger RNA is also playing a regulatory role, regulating the gene expression patterns of other RNA molecules, that you have RNAs that are part of this integrated network of RNA molecules where the expression of one RNA is regulating or controlling the expression of other RNAs and the process of approaching of translation at ribosomes as well. And so even though those pseudogenes may not be coding functional receptor proteins, they still are actually taking an active role in that regulatory network.
You know, but what seems so strange about that is that you're saying here God made humans from scratch, and let's say he needs some kind of regulatory action, and so he designs that with the code that happens to be a chopped up version that is the same of olfactory sense in a different creature that works in the olfactory sense. Doesn't that seem strange?
You're looking at it from an evolutionary framework. Prior to Darwin, the theoretical construct in biology was largely developed by Sir Richard Owen, who developed this concept of an archetype, who argued that shared features that you see in organisms, at this time he's dealing at an anatomical level, but shared features reflected the work of a creator that employed a common archetype. And that archetype then is manifested in different ways within the created order. And he saw that as being, again, reflecting the work of a creator or the ideas or concepts that existed in the mind of a creator. So the concept here is that shared features reflect common design, not common descent, where even though human beings would be uniquely made in God's image, it doesn't mean that we wouldn't necessarily share biological features with other creatures, but you could see those shared features as reflecting a common design, not common descent. And in that framework, then you would expect to see a function as opposed to a non-function for features like pseudogenes. And what I point out in the update to Who Was Adam is that we are discovering almost universal function for pseudogenes, and this includes duplicated and unitary pseudogenes, and that function relates not to the production of proteins in terms of the pseudogenes encoding information that translates into protein products, but they play a role in terms of gene regulation through this organizing concept that's being built, the competitive endogenous RNA hypothesis.
It doesn't make sense to me, because it sounds like what you're saying to me is that, let's say, example, God created some kind of a mammal with genes for the olfactory sense. And then what happens is, when he made humans, we don't have that olfactory sense anymore. But he says, oh, I'm going to use that same code and hack it up and use it for some other process, when he could have made something from scratch, I guess. But it's like, why would you... It's like this block of code is copied and modified, but it just doesn't seem to make sense if he was making things from scratch. But yeah, I think we have to leave it there to move on.
Sure.
I'll give you just 20 seconds if you just want to just quickly end this section on this.
Yeah, and I would basically make the point that what people oftentimes are pointing to as overwhelming evidence for common descent and human evolution are features in nature that could be interpreted from a design framework or a creation framework and have explanation, ready explanation within that framework.
Okay, well, we went twice as long on this one, so we're going to have to take out some time on the other ones. So the other one is Noah's Ark. How do you look at Noah's Ark in light of modern science? From my understanding, you believe there was a local flood that wiped out all humans except for 8 saved on an ark. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's the view I would take, is that the flood described in Scripture is a real historical event, and that Noah and his wife and 3 sons and their wives were the sole survivors, that the flood impacted all of humanity.
Now, the most obvious question I have on that is, why would all of humanity be in one spot? I mean, even you yourself in debates have said that, you talk about this migration of humans, out of Africa and all this. It's not like people left Africa as a group and stayed together. There would have been people leaving and people staying and people spreading out all over the place. So it just seems inconceivable that people would be in one local area to be killed in a flood.
Yeah, well, I mean, when you look at the origin of humanity, there does appear to be, from the scientific data, a geographical region where humanity does have its genesis, and that humanity does migrate from that area outward. And so when you look at the migration patterns, there is a fanning out that takes place from a point of origin. And so I would argue that the genetic data and the archaeological data and even paleolinguistics all point to the idea that there is a fanning out of humanity that fan has its center at or near the Middle East.
So is that from Noah's Ark, or is that from Adam and Eve, you're saying?
Well, I would say that migration would reflect an event that happened after the flood. So I would, use the scientific data to estimate the time of the flood as being in the 50 to 60,000 year range, given that's what the scientific data seems to indicate. There's nothing in the biblical text that really gives us, I think, a strong clue as to when that migration would have happened.
Well, let me ask you some simple questions now. If so, you're saying the flood was probably about 50,000 years ago?
Yes.
and it was a local flood. How local is it? Is it covering like 5 miles or 500 miles or what?
It would basically have covered the general area of Mesopotamia. I mean, people that hold to a progressive creation view and a local flood view, I think, would have some debate as to exactly what the extent of the flood is, but it would be largely confined to the Mesopotamia area.
Now, and why wouldn't other humans have boats to get out of this? I mean, what's so hard about getting in a boat, and if it's a local flood, just to go somewhere else?
Well, if it was a dramatic event where the waters rose rather quickly, then there wouldn't have been time for people to escape. That would be essentially the argument.
Well, if they had fisher boats, I mean, if they knew how to fish, is that before people had boats? People invented boats, and this is like the first boat. Noah invented the first boat,
or I mean, in a sense, I don't know the answer to that question.
I mean, because
I would just simply go by, in that juncture, what Scripture is saying, that Noah is building this, very large boat. But part of the process of building that boat is he was essentially preaching the coming judgment on humanity. And so the boat was, again, rather massive. I've not really spent time studying specifically the size of the dimensions of the boat and that type of thing. But it was clearly a rather significant undertaking.
And why would he save birds if it was a local flood? I mean, birds, it seems like they could easily fly to higher ground, I would think.
Yeah, well, I mean, the process of, taking animals on board the ark was not meant to save those animals, but rather is meant to have creatures on board that Noah and his family would use to reestablish civilization after they came off of the boat. And the animals that were taken on board the boat were either for, again, reestablishing civilization, or they would have been used for sacrifice purposes.
Do you think he took all the local animals, like the snakes and the turtles or frogs and salamanders and all that?
No, actually, when you examine the text in Genesis 6 through 9, the flood account, it's very clear from the text when you read it in the original Hebrew that Noah was bringing very specific types of animals on board the ark. It wasn't every creature. There were specific types of creatures that were designed to fulfill a function of either survive, helping Noah and his family to survive on the ark and survive after the flood event took place, and a creature that they would use for sacrifice or for religious purposes.
Well, it doesn't seem like, do you believe that the flood happened like for over a year, according to the Bible?
Yeah, I mean, I would take what the Bible says at face value.
He had such few animals on there, that wouldn't even be enough to last a week. I mean, if he was going to eat them on board.
Well, I don't know that it says that he ate them, but those animals were there on board, again, to reestablish civilization, or that there would be creatures that he would use while he was on board the ark for survival. It doesn't mean that they were necessarily eating those creatures.
Okay, any last statements before we go into the next section?
I would say that when you look at the biblical account of the flood, oftentimes people think of this in terms of a global flood, but there are a number of Christians who would look at it as a real historical event that involved a local flood, and that there is scientific data that is consistent with the spread of humanity after the flood event.
What's the most obvious reason that it was not a global flood?
Well, for example, if you look at passages like Psalm 104, which is a creation account, when it describes the creation of land, which would have corresponded to the third day of creation in Genesis 1, it talks about the land being produced and that there's a boundary that was created at the time that the land was produced over which the waters would never again, overwhelm. And so the passages like Psalm 104, for example, when they, again, are referring to the creation of the land, make it very clear that the earth was never going to return to a water world again, as it was described in Genesis 1-2, and then reiterated in Psalm 104. So that would be one reason why I would say that it has to be a local flood, not a global flood.
Well, do you think it's also obvious that there's no physical evidence of a worldwide flood, and if there was one, there'd be, you know, marks all over the place, and there's no marks of it?
Yes. I mean, that would be another reason is that, I mean, you know, for example, there's not enough water on the planet to cover the Earth, you know, mm-hmm. To cover the entire surface of the Earth. And so, yeah, there's a number of reasons, scientific reasons, why the flood simply couldn't be a global flood.
Yeah, plus, so all the animals on the ark and all that. And
right. So it does factor into the, you know, into the argument that it was a local flood, not a global flood.
Okay.
But on the other hand, there's plenty of clues in the text that are that suggest that it was a local flood, and you wind up with incoherencies with other passages of Scripture that deal with creation when you argue it's a global flood as opposed to a local flood. So in order to maintain consistency in interpreting all the scriptural passages that relate whether directly or indirectly to the flood account, you have to adopt a local flood interpretation.
Okay, so let's go on to the next section. This is on morality. And this, it says, is morality grounded in God? And the reason why is because in atheists and Christian debates, you'll frequently hear the Christians say that you need God for morality, and that when the atheist talks about morality, he's actually stealing from the Christian worldview, because good and evil don't make any sense, or good and bad don't make any sense without God. I mean, to me, it's, let me just tell you my viewpoint. I mean, to me, it's quite simple to understand that good is, it's all about behavior. Morality is all about behavior, and good is what's encourages flourishing, and bad is what's bad. It discourages flourishing, or it causes pain and bad feelings. So, for example, that's why it's good to help starving people, or it's good to give people hugs, and it's bad to go around killing people you don't like. So it's really kind of obvious what's good and bad, because those are the targets about flourishing in the community. So, as a Christian, you might say that morality is just what God commands. Is that what you would say, or how do you define morality?
Well, I think I would define morality as the way that we ought to behave and the way that we ought to treat other people, and that I would argue that that is indeed, you know, what our morality has its basis in terms of what Scripture teaches and ultimately what God commands, but I would argue that it actually emerges ultimately from the very essence of God himself. And so that would be where I would argue morality comes from.
Well, so here's the obvious question. Suppose the prophet came and said that God wants you to start killing babies.
But again, you know, that would be inconsistent with the nature of God as we see revealed through Scripture.
How is it inconsistent? I mean, that's just God's command. God said to do it.
Yes, well...
and for example, you know, you have the story with Abraham and Isaac, you know. God said, kill your son, so... If you felt like you had that message, you know, to kill your child from God, how do you know that's wrong?
Yeah, I see your point there, but I think you also have to look at the story in the broader context of what God was doing, like let's say in the case of Abraham and Isaac, because there the intent ultimately wasn't for Abraham to kill his son, but it was to see if he was willing to be obedient to God, to essentially to sacrifice that which was the most important thing to Abraham. And so it was essentially, again, if you will, a test of Abraham's willingness to obey, where God ultimately provided the sacrifice in that situation. But it also was, a foreshadowing of what God himself was going to do when he sent his son to die on the cross. And so there's a larger context. But I wouldn't say that it represents normative behavior in terms of what God expects of people. I mean, that behavior would have been laid out in the Ten Commandments and elsewhere in Scripture. And so I think it's inappropriate to probably take an exceptional circumstance and then use that as being a general principle that Christians would adhere to or would be expected to adhere to.
No, but the point is, if God just gave a command, how do you know if it's good or bad command?
Well, because it would be based on your view of God's nature, and if you would argue that God's nature is ultimately good, then you would argue that that command, again, is something that emanates out of his nature, and there may be a larger reason for why God would have you do something like that.
Right. So, I mean, if God said to do something, and I said, oh, my gosh, that is terrible. That's the most immoral thing you can do. And you can say, like, well, I don't understand it, but maybe God has bigger reasons for it.
Right. But, you know, I think, very few Christians would argue that God would be directly speaking to them and commanding them to do those types of things. And let's say if you did have an instance where you thought that was the case, the protocol would be that you would check that against the nature of God's character and also what you saw within Scripture. And so whatever God would command of you would be consistent with his character.
Well, yeah, consistent with Scripture, that's a tricky one, because, I mean, people might say that the New Testament is not consistent with the Old Testament. You know, the idea of God becoming man and dying on the cross, I mean, there's a reason why the Jews rejected that.
But yet, when you look throughout the prophecies, it's very clear that is what the prophets were pointing to or speaking to. And so, you know, the expression is, that in the Old Testament Christ is concealed, and in the New Testament Christ is revealed.
Okay.
And so, you know, when you read the New Testament in light of the Old Testament, you see that the concepts there form a continuum between the Old and the New Testaments.
Well, let me give you a quick example here. Let's say, for example, in Oregon, we just couple days ago, it's now legal to use marijuana for anybody. You know, it used to be just sick people. Now anybody can do it. So some people would say taking drugs is immoral. It's against God's laws. And some people might say, hey, it's not immoral. How do you know if something like that is immoral or not, good or bad?
Yeah, well, you know, the principle that you would see in Scripture that I think would apply would be the closest principle that or analog would be dealing with drinking, where, you know, there's no prohibition against consuming alcohol in the Old or the New Testament, but the prohibition would be, again, against using alcohol in excess. And so I would argue that it's probably, in my personal opinion, imprudent to smoke marijuana, but I don't think smoking marijuana would be an act of immorality. Necessarily from a Christian perspective, but I think, you know, using marijuana or abusing marijuana would probably be an act that would be immoral.
Okay, so you would say that if a person used marijuana reasonably, that would not be a sin, that would not be bad.
I would not label it as a sin, but I don't think I would, you know, I would argue that it's probably not a prudent way to live one's life, but, you know, I don't see that necessarily as a sinful behavior. But, you know, I mean, in a sense, let me ask you a question, because from my perspective, unless you adopt a position that there is an objective basis for morality, it seems like ultimately, though, you're forced into frameworks where you're defining morality in rather arbitrary terms. Because you mentioned that that one of the ideals that you would embrace would be the idea of behaviors that would encourage human flourishing.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a question would be why is even promoting human flourishing necessarily an ideal in and of itself? You know, from a Christian perspective, you mm-hmm. would say humans are made in God's image, and of course, flourishing of humanity under those conditions is in line with treating human beings with respect and inherent worth and dignity. Mm-hmm. But from a perspective where you're looking at human beings as being just one among other species, how would you then even justify human flourishing as a framework for morality?
Well, I think it's kind of obvious that it could go boil down to pain and pleasure, that the best thing is for everybody to feel good, and the worst thing is for everybody to feel bad. And if people went around killing and hurting each other, that'd be a very bad society. If people were nice to each other and helped each other, that society would thrive. And so it's all about the behavior. And I think most people would prefer to be in a society that's very peaceful and loving and getting along and having good feelings. I mean, isn't that kind of obvious? I don't really understand why it's a complex question. I know people ask that, but I don't see the difficulty in it.
Well, I think the idea here would be, at least from my perspective, is that idea does seem obvious to everybody, and it's because I would argue from a Christian perspective that we have a law written on our hearts.
Mm. And yeah, just the opposite. I would say do not follow your heart at all, because, like one of my moral philosophies is to highly prize individual rights, for example. So like with homosexual behavior, for example, I'm not a homosexual. It's not something I want to do. But I also believe that people should be free to do what they want as long as they don't hurt other people. That's kind of a libertarian thing. So, if people were against things that they felt were icky, that would not be good for a lot of people. I mean, you might be doing things that people don't like and appreciate, but you'd say, thank God I live in America where I have freedom.
Right, but so you have a particular moral framework where you espouse individual rights, but what if somebody came along and said, well, I have a moral framework where I think individual rights are actually a dangerous thing, that ultimately it should be up to the cooperative to decide what rights are that people have, and that the individual shouldn't be able to exercise their rights, but only those things that are permissible are determined by the state.
That would be an interesting discussion, because what our agreement would be is we're both looking at the end point and we're trying to have the best society, right? And so that's what we have in agreement. And so what's the best way to get there? And that'd be an interesting discussion to have. But you're coming from a different perspective where you're saying don't even use your brain, just what feels right. And I'm strongly against that.
But I guess my point would be, you could actually adopt a moral system where the goal is not to have the best possible society for everybody, but the best possible society for a particular group of people, mm-hmm. and that position is equally as valid as a position that you would adopt, where you would say we want the best possible society for as many people as possible. We want people to be able to exercise individual rights. Those become essentially arbitrary categories where what determines whether we live according to your principles or to, an alternate set of principles.
Yeah, have you heard of the veil of ignorance in philosophy, moral ethics?
No.
So basically that would take care of that situation there. Basically, when you try to set up a moral society, you try to set it up without knowing what you're going to be in it. You could be a bum, or you could be a doctor, or you could be the president of the U.S., or a billionaire, or a pauper. And so the veil of ignorance means you set up the society not knowing what you're going to be, and then when you're thrown into it, you say, hey, this is a fair society. So that's one moral philosophy tool to help do that. Well, shall we move on?
Sure.
Okay, yeah, we've got so much to talk about. I feel like we're cutting everything short. This one will probably be a short one. Well, maybe just 5 minutes on this one. So, William Lane Craig, I'm sure you know who he is. He's a very popular Christian debater. He'll give evidences for why it's reasonable to believe in God, but he'll say that he has said that, you know, these evidences are what I would give in a debate, but personally, that's not the reason why he believes. He believes mostly because he has a personal relationship with Jesus. And a lot of Christian apologists will say that, you know, I have a relationship with God just like I have a relationship with my wife. And just like I wouldn't doubt the existence of my wife, I wouldn't doubt the existence of, you know, God, because I could feel this. And I would say that that is a logical fallacy of appeal to emotion, that you cannot determine if something exists or not based on your feelings. And one story I give about that is I talked to some Mormons, and they said, pray about the Book of Mormon. If it's true, God will give you a burning in the bosom. I prayed about it, I got the burning in the bosom, and I was a Mormon for about 5 seconds because my brain kicked in and said, Bernie, you can't believe this because of what you know. I knew too much about the Book of Mormon, that I knew it was a sham religion. So even though my feelings led me astray, my brain saved me, in effect. And so I once was an evangelical born-again Christian. I know what it feels like to be led by God. That's when somebody says they're led by God or they feel the presence of God. I know that, and I now believe is a delusion. So what is your take on all of this?
Yeah, well, that's interesting, because there's a fascinating argument that Richard Swinburne, who is a philosopher of religion, is also a theist, but there's an interesting argument that Swinburne advocates, and it's called the argument from religious experience. And he basically is arguing that when you look at Christians around the world today, in fact, throughout church history, you have a very large number of Christians that report basically having religious experiences, and that he would basically argue that these religious experiences have a profound effect on people's lives, universally making them better people, more loving and more sacrificial, and that these experiences seem to be very real to the people that have had them. And so he argues that if someone has an experience, again, like a religious experience, and it's rational to conclude that they actually had that experience, unless there are some specific reasons why we would think that they are deluded. And, you know, it's possible that some people very well could be deluded when it comes to, again, claiming to have religious experiences, but it's unreasonable to think that everybody who claims to have had those experiences would be deluded, and that we should take those statements at face value unless, again, we have reasons not to think that's the case. And in fact, that's the same principle, according to Swinburne, that we would use in a court of law, where if somebody claims that they've observed something or have had an experience, that we assume it to be true unless there's reasons we think that it isn't true. I mean, that's essentially what we do when we have eyewitnesses that are, you know, presumably have seen a crime being committed, is that we assume that their testimony is reliable unless we have reasons to think otherwise. So, you know, I would argue that I think those religious experiences that Christians have are real experiences and is a legitimate reason to believe in God.
Well, so what do you think about me praying about the Book of Mormon and getting the feeling from God about it? We both agree that the Book of Mormon is a work of fiction, right?
Yes.
So
yeah, I agree with that.
How do you explain that? I mean, I think it's actually a pretty brilliant move, because I think what happened in psychologically is that if you're an honest person and you honestly, with all your heart, are seeking the truth, there's something emotional that happens that, I don't know, I think there was something emotional there. It was some kind of a trick. And it may be a trick where somebody can really bond with you, while they'll say, like, you know, let's be honest, come on, you know, and then It, I don't know, it just does something to you, like it puts your armor down, you know, arms down or something. I don't know.
Well, I mean, you know, I've sincerely prayed to see if the Book of Mormon was true. I prayed with Mormon missionaries, and I've never had that burning in my bosom. And so, I didn't have that experience. It's not to say that people who are Mormons didn't have that experience, but I never had that experience.
But I have had
what I would say, you know, authentic religious experiences. In fact, that was one of the key reasons that I converted to Christianity. As I was reading through the Sermon on the Mount, and I was, you know, by myself actually in a chemistry lab, and it was in the evening, and I was reading through the Sermon on the Mount. I was at that point convinced that there was a creator that existed, but had no conviction otherwise as to who or what that creator was, and was reading the scriptures based on the encouragement of a pastor who I had, you know, had an interaction with. And it literally was as if there was a presence in the room with me while I was reading that passage, and I had the overwhelming conviction that this was true. And I've never had an experience like that before that, and I never had an experience like that afterwards. And so I would say that was a genuine experience that I've had. And so that's not the sole reason why I believe in Christianity, but that was, again, a real experience that I had. It was a real experience, just in the same way that you know, seeing the sun set or the sun rise is a real experience for me. That convinces me that the sun is that the sun exists, and that the earth is rotating around the sun, or mm-hmm. revolving around the sun.
You know, you talk about this real experience. It reminds me when I was earlier, as a Christian, I was with a group, and we were studying Neil Anderson's The Bondage Breaker, I believe it is. And he talks about all these demon stories, and people in the group were getting demonic things. And I remember praying and feeling a presence sometimes, and like waking up and looking out, and I see like there's a cross on the wall, and it's like, and it's coming like from the blinders because of the holes in the blinders, and it's like I see a cross there, and some people in the group are getting all these freaky things, and what we were talking to the pastor about, it's like, why is this stuff happening to us? And it's like, well, it's probably because we're getting into the spiritual realm, you know. When you go into the spiritual realm, the devil's fighting back. And then I started going to a Calvary Chapel where they were saying, you know, how the Toronto Blessing and all these spiritual things are just going off the rails, basically. And so my mind kind of got cleared up a little bit more sane, I think. And then, of course, all those experiences went away, too. I wasn't so freaked out and, you know, seeing everything spiritual and all that. So you can kind of see how where the head's at is how you interpret and see things, and almost freaking yourself out, like with dreams, you know, in your dreams, you're freaking yourself out. It's your brain freaking out another part of your brain. So it's kind of a weird situation.
Yeah, well, you know, and I think that it's important when somebody is having, thinks that they've had a religious experience, that you are, you know, thoughtful about it, and that you do apply reason to that experience. I think that that those experiences that you had, in my opinion, could have been very real experiences, and I'm sure they felt real to you at the time.
Yeah, it definitely felt real. Yeah, but I mean, now I think it's a bunch of mind games. Yeah, you see hypnosis, and they can plant. There's so many ways to trick the mind. If you know Darren Brown, who's a mentalist, who's very famous in the UK, he has so many YouTube videos about all kinds of religious nature. I mean, there's one where he's an atheist, and he actually converted another atheist to Christianity, and then he had to like deconvert him and tell him the tricks he used and stuff. So, well, I don't know, it seems to me the mind could be manipulated pretty easily with hypnosis and suggestions and things like that. And then I think what can really save you is when you have knowledge, you know. So for example, somebody says, here's a holy book like the Book of Mormon, you could gobble that up and believe that, but if you know enough about history and if you even look at what the critics say about it, you can say like, oh yeah, of course this is nonsense. And so it really takes the brain to save the heart, because if you didn't have that brain knowledge, your heart would just go haywire just following any kind of weird thing. The heaven's gate crawling through all kinds of things.
Well, you know, and I would agree with that. And you know, from the point that I converted to Christianity, and I would argue that a significant part of that conversion process involved coming to the intellectual conviction that there was a creator that existed, and then, of course, asking the question who that creator was. But then afterwards, it was continuing applying a test of reason to scriptures and to the claims of the Christian faith. And so from my perspective, you know, I see the creation accounts in scripture as having scientific credibility. I see the Christian faith as having historical credibility. I think, you know, when you even look at the person of Christ, his life, his death, and his resurrection, there's a very powerful, you know, and compelling historical argument one could make that I think Mormonism lacks in terms of the Book of Mormon or the Book of Abraham or the Pearl of Great Price. And so I think there are ways in which you can, you know, use reason to evaluate those experiences that you had and to evaluate the faith system or the philosophical system that you embrace.
This is the section, why is there something rather than nothing? And like I said earlier, sometimes people now with the multiverse theory, they would say, why is there something instead of everything? Because with multiverse theory, there could be so many universes and alternate universes and all that. So let me ask you one question about this. I don't know. Do you have? Let me give it to you. What would you like to say? What would you like to say to the atheists about this?
About the idea of why is there something rather than nothing?
Yeah, you know, the way I see it is that you really have two options: either the universe, everything popped out of nothing, or else something always existed. And the problem is that neither one of them makes sense to us humans because we cannot observe either one of those happening. We cannot. Right. Understand what it is. And personally, I think I would lean towards that something always existed. And that's the way I would lean. That would be like the multiverse theory or something, but not this intelligent being that created everything.
Yeah, well, okay, that's interesting. Yeah, the way I guess I like to think about that whole question is I'm not so sure I find, quite frankly, the question, why is there something rather than nothing, compelling? Because in a sense, if there was nothing, then there would be no way that we would know that there was nothing. So I've never found that particular question compelling one way or the other. But on the other hand, the idea of you know, the fact that we see that at least the universe that we can observe, for all that we understand, seems to have a beginning. And my point would be that at minimum lines up with the idea of creation ex nihilo, which I think is taught, for example, in Genesis 1:1 or Hebrews 11:3, that, and so I would say that the fact that we discover a beginning to the universe is consistent with the idea that the ideas that we see in Scripture, and if there is a beginning, there must be something outside the universe, at least that we can observe, that caused the universe. And I think you're right to point out that it could either be a multiverse, or it could be, you know, a personal creator. But ultimately, both you and I would have to posit an uncaused cause. So if you're embracing a multiverse, interestingly enough, even all viable multiverse theories require a beginning to the multiverse. So you really don't escape the problem of a beginning. But
well, I wouldn't agree with that. The multiverse is totally beyond comprehension. You can't say it requires a beginning.
Well, but people have done mathematical modeling to try to explain phenomena within this universe that would be consistent with the idea of a multiverse and all of the models that are reasonable models basically require a beginning. And that's something that's been well established by theoretical physicists, as much as you could establish ideas like that.
Well, I would strongly argue against that. I mean, I take, for example, Einstein came up with this space-time fabric idea. And, you know, prior to Einstein, people thought space and time were two different things. And so with space-time, everything has changed. And when you look at, like, quantum entanglement, that supposedly you can entangle two particles and separate them across the universe, and when you modify one, the other one's modified. Nothing travels faster than the speed of light, we know, and physicists say they are clueless about how these things are connected. They have no... One physicist said it's like we don't know anything. We don't even know the fabric of reality here. So there is so much unknown here. So to me, it seems ridiculous to say that, well, you know, multiverse theory, this would have to be true about the multiverse. I mean, we have so much unknowns.
And all I'm pointing out is what theoretical physicists who work on this problem have concluded. And there's a great book that we have available through our organization called Who's Afraid of the Multiverse, written by an astrophysicist who's looked into this idea of the multiverse, Jeff Zwirink, and he basically argues that, you know, and points to the scientific literature, that every model for the multiverse that, again, would be considered to be a reasonable model by theoretical physicists demands a beginning to the multiverse. People who are arguing, you know, like you would argue that there was always something, would say that prior to the universe, this is Lawrence Krauss and Stephen Hawking would argue that there was this eternally existing gravitational field, and out of that field you can explain the multiverse and hence our local universe. But ultimately they're positing an uncaused cause that brought everything into existence, and that's, I would argue, is metaphysically equivalent to a Christian positing an uncaused cause that was a personality that brought everything into existence.
It seems to me that you're wrong in saying that they, like Lawrence Krauss says, that there was a field that generated the multiverse. I think he was saying there's a field that generated the Big Bang, for example, but not the multiverse.
No, I think it's the multiverse.
I disagree with you there. I don't think they say anything about the multiverse. I think you're confusing the origin of this universe with multiverse.
Well, regardless, the point that I'm making is that everybody has to posit an uncaused cause in order to, you can't get away from having an uncaused cause, because nothing, if you're looking at things in a strictly naturalistic perspective, there is never a point where there's nothing, and that nothing then causes something. There's always something that exists that ultimately is the ultimate cause, and again, that's functionally equivalent to a Christian perspective that there was a creator that brought everything into existence, that and that creator was uncaused.
Okay, I got to ask you a question. This is kind of like I think I can make a comedy routine out of this question, I think, so I want to see how you answer it. You're saying that God is the uncaused cause. He's eternally existing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Imagine if you're God. God is supposed to know everything, but one thing he doesn't know is how he came to be. It's like he just found himself existing. He didn't make himself. So it's like, what a lucky guy this is. How did he just... He just happened to find himself existing. Isn't that crazy?
Well, you know, I guess I would respond to your question in a similar way that you are to use a point that you made earlier about quantum entanglement, that there are things going on in this universe that we don't seem to have a clue or an understanding of, and that we may not have the capability of ever understanding things that comprise the universe, or ever having, you know, explanations for things that comprise the universe. And so, in a sense, you know, we have a finite capacity, and so, you know, when we ask ourselves questions about God and God's eternal nature, in a sense, it's a category that we have no experience that helps us even to begin to comprehend what that is. And so, it may be that the question that you're asking, which to you and I seems to be like a really good question, may actually be an absurd statement if we had the wherewithal to appreciate what it was like to be an eternally existing being.
I mean, I'm just thinking, you know, like, neither one of us created ourselves. We gradually emerge and we find ourselves existing. And it's like, well, you know, this is me and that's you. What if you would have found yourself to be God and said, like, oh, wow, I don't know how I came about, but it's me, you know?
But I guess if you were an eternally existing being, that may be a question that you never would even ask. In other words, our experience is that things all have an origin, that things have a point where they come into existence. And there is a point where, if you're a sentient being, that you have an awareness that you came into existence. But if you were an eternal being, mm-hmm. that just simply may not be something that, again, categorically, you would ever even entertain, because it would be an absurdity from that perspective. So,
but he doesn't know how he came to exist. I mean, it's the same question. Why is there something rather than nothing? Why is there God instead of nothing? Why isn't there just nothing? Well, you know, why is there a God? Why is there stuff? How did God find himself existing?
Well, I mean, you could even ask the same question. Well, why would there be a multiverse, or why would there be, mm-hmm. You know, an eternally existing gravitational field?
Right. You know, but in some ways, though, it's really weird to think about. But maybe it all equals out to nothing in the end. I mean, like, for example, in algebra, you could have 0 = 0. Well, you could add 5 to both. You could add 5 to one side and put 2 + 3 on the other side. You have actually different numbers, but you still have 0. But there's, you know, so you can pop up with a 5 = 5, but, you know, in different forms, but in the end, it's equal. So maybe that's the way reality is. Maybe, you know, time came into existence at some point, and it's going to be gone. Here we are just passing through this time that was created. I mean, yeah, there's just so much we don't understand. I mean, like with quantum mechanics, we just don't even understand the fabric of reality, it seems like.
Well, and I guess, you know, my point would be, given what we are capable of understanding, you know, what kind of conclusions can we draw about the nature of reality and the nature of humanity, given what we know? And in a sense, that's all we can do, is to try to make sense of reality based on what we know. And, you know, and I would maintain that, given everything that we know, It's at minimum reasonable to think that there is a creator that's personal, that brought everything into existence, and I think there it's rational to embrace the Christian faith. I don't know that I'll just leave it at that.
Okay, so we'll have a little wrap-up here time of about 3 or 4 minutes. I want to give you a chance to say anything that you felt like you didn't get a finish, or you want to set straight or something. I would like to say that, you know, I followed your work for quite some time, even when I was a Christian, and I really appreciate you. I appreciate the things, I mean, you know 100 times more than about biology than I do, I think, but I think it's kind of perplexing how I think I see evidence for evolution and you don't. So. It was an interesting pseudo-gene discussion, and something I feel like is basically unresolved. We really need to talk about that some more. And then also like the fused human chromosome number 2, stuff like that. But I just wanted to say that I do appreciate you a lot. You're probably one of my favorite Christians. I think you're a great role model for Christians. The only thing that can make you better is if you accepted evolution. But if you accepted evolution, you know the baggage you're going to pick up there. I mean, that's why I left the faith, because I felt like I had to accept evolution because of the science. And then I just could not reconcile that with theology. And maybe that's why you're refusing evolution, because you know you can't reconcile it. I'm not sure. So.
Well, you know, I mean, you know, first of all, thank you. That's very kind of you to say. And, you know, I always enjoy interacting with you. I think you are a truth seeker, and I think you're, you know, a very forthright and honest person, and I think you really strive to have genuine dialogue with people who differ from you, so I really appreciate that. And, you know, in large measure, I think your assessment is a fair one, because I've got a lot of reasons why I embrace the truth of the Christian faith. And as I look at the human origins account specifically, I just don't see how you reconcile that with the idea of human evolution. And you know, and I do think there are places where the evolutionary paradigm doesn't have sufficient explanatory power, and it, you know, like the origin of life would be one instance of that. And I do see, you know, evidence for design when I look at biological systems. And so, on that basis, I feel like I have a starting point to at least express skepticism about the evolutionary paradigm. I do understand why people argue that there's evidence for common descent, but you know, my project then it would be is if you embrace a design framework or a creation framework, can you make sense of the shared genomic features that you see? And I think the answer is increasingly yes. That in other words, it doesn't demand a common descent interpretation to make sense of the shared genetic features. But I also think that it's reasonable for somebody to look at that data and say it's evidence for common descent. I just choose not to do that. But what I'm also trying to do then is to make sure that we can actually, if we don't, can actually account for the data and try not to sweep things under the rug, but genuinely try to account for the data.
One quick question. Why do you think people like Dennis Venema and Francis Collins, who are evangelical Christians in science, they fully accept evolution? What mistake are they making? Do you think they're just... How do you in your mind, sort that out, what their problem is?
Well, you know, I think they are... it's hard to know what motivates an individual, but I think they genuinely feel compelled by the evidence that that common descent took place. But I think what they do theologically speaking, in the way in which they are handling Scripture, to me, I feel very uncomfortable with. I think what they are producing is something that is not historic Christianity. And so, you know, I think their issue is that they are forcing I think real questions about the trustworthiness of Scripture, and I think it undermines a lot of key Christian doctrines.
Is there something scientifically they're missing, do you think, or you think it's just their worldview, the way they're approaching it philosophically?
I think I would say that I think it's the way they're approaching the data philosophically. No, I don't think there's anything that they're missing scientifically, but I think it's something that they're approaching philosophically. But I've engaged them both and other people at Biologos, in my opinion, they also are rather unwilling to even consider the possibility that there could be alternate frameworks in which you could interpret the data. You know, and what motivates them tremendously is maintaining, in their minds, credibility with the scientific community. Mm-hmm. And so they basically argue both publicly and privately that, you know, evangelicals are going to lose all credibility with the scientific community if we don't embrace evolution, you know, as the organizing framework. You know, I think that's, for a Christian, I think that's an unusual position to adopt. I don't think we ever want to ignore scientific data by any means. I'm not saying that. But on the other hand, I think we should feel comfortable developing models or theories that may not align with the mainstream if we feel like those ideas are consistent with Scripture and mainstream scientific ideas don't align with Scripture. I think we should have that freedom to explore those alternate possibilities as Christians, and they just, you know, they seem to be unwilling. But, I mean, I would argue that ultimately the core of the Christian faith is, an idea that's scientifically absurd, namely that a man rose from the dead. You know, and so, you know, if you're looking at scientific credibility as being your criteria for what you will and won't accept, then why stop at Adam and Eve, in a sense? If you're arguing, well, that's not a scientifically credible story, well, neither is the resurrection, so why stop at Adam and Eve? And I think, you know, Jerry Coyne has made pointed statements to that effect regarding BioLogos. I recall reading something that he had written on a blog or to that effect. So, I mean, I think the position that you've come to embrace is probably a logical consequence of being convinced that evolution is true and not being able to square it with Scripture. So I think they're operating with cognitive dissonance. Maybe you could accuse me of operating with cognitive dissonance too. But
well, I think it's interesting. We're all we're fairly young. We've got a number of years left, and sometimes people change their minds. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens through the years as science progresses, as our knowledge progresses. It'll be interesting. Maybe I'll become a Christian, you'll become an atheist, and we'll have a debate on the opposite side. You never know, right?
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Well. Thanks, Fuzz. It was I really enjoyed talking to you, so I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Bernie. It always seems to go fast. So.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, well, you have a good evening.
Okay, you too. Good night.
Good night.